CTV, we have to break them into individual deformities.
Focus.
Yes. Camera zoom பண்ணு பாதுல.
நம்ம zoom பண்ணுங்க. இந்த மூஞ்சி கட வேணாம். Yes. அப்பப்ப இங்க காமிங்க. அப்பப்ப மூஞ்சி காமிச்சோம். So we have to break them into individual deformities. We have a equinus, but in this particular case there is not much of equinus. And the hind foot varus. Can you look at the hind foot varus here? So this varus is what we need to correct. Then there is a forefoot adduction element and a cavus. Most of cavus we corrected right on the table by a plantar fissure release or whatever. And if it is too tough a cavus, then you need to have a cavus correction assembly mounted. In this particular prefab, we are not incorporating any cavus correction part since we assume that we are going to correct it all on the table.
Now one point. With a pencil, mark everything on the this model.
Yes.
Or on limb also. With a pencil, how much varus is there, how much rotation of the foot is there, how much cavus is there, how much equinus is there.
You must mark the long axis of the leg, long axis of the hind foot, long axis of the, yes. The cavus have to be marked like this. This is the hind forefoot adduction component, this is the forefoot adduction component, this is the hind foot varus component, and this is what is equinus.
Equinus.
This is what is equinus. Effectively, there is no equinus here. Probably after correcting the hind foot varus, we will be seeing what real equinus is left. So, on this basis, using the limb as a template, we make a prefabricated construct. What we do here is, it's like doing laparoscopic surgery. See there and see what is being shot. And what exactly we have to do is, we have to feed, give the child a lot of chocolates, a lot of ice cream. Keep them happy when you make the prefabricated construct, because you don't want a crying child when you make this assembly and in a haste. So here you can see that there are two hinges in the posterior aspect. These hinges will help us to accommodate the hindfoot varus. Exactly, the replicating the hindfoot varus in this case. And these rods, when we distract differentially, we correct the hind foot varus. And when we distract them equally, we use it for equinus correction. And here, look at the foot, this thing, foot part of the construct. This is the limb. You can see that there is a provision for differential distraction. This was made with the limb as the template. Now I am superimposing it just like how we will be doing it in the operation theater. So since it is all assembled, we don't have to do much. Only have to insert 8 wires and come out, have a coffee, then start thinking about how to correct it in the postoperative period. So this is how the limb will look like in the postoperative period. You see the calcaneal ring exactly fits parallel to the heel, and the foot assembly, forefoot assembly exactly perpendicular to the metatarsals. Accommodating the varus and the cavus, and the leg coming center in the the leg coming exactly center in the leg ring. Okay,
yes.
And we might have to add a second ring in certain situations where we need tibial lengthening also, or tibial intorsion correction also. Fine. So how do we start? This frame you are all comfortable with? How it's being made? Any doubts? Any questions? Any apprehensions? Yes.
Sir, how to measure that angle of the hip?
Yes, this angle is measured this way.
On weight bearing X-ray.
On weight bearing X-ray or clinically?
Or clinically.
Clinically, with the pencil markings that
you,
we made.
You
we
mark the center of the hip.
The same part which drawn the lines on.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Those lines should stay parallel and perpendicular to the rings. And you see here, if I place the leg in the center of the leg ring, the leg in the center of the tibial ring,
equidistant from the frame,
the heel will be exactly in the position of the heel ring, and foot will be exactly in the position of the foot ring, then you know you are in the right place. So this varus you have to keep adjusting, this varus you have to keep adjusting accordingly and try to replicate. I am moving my right hand, this comes outside, this comes inside. Okay? Any more questions? So far, so good? Very good.
How about these distractors?
Instructor, yes. You see here, now I'll try to put it back again. When you can see that there is 4 foot adduction here. According to the amount of adduction, we assemble the medial and lateral foot destructors. Hope it's being seen here. This is where the heel ring heel gets parked on the final assembly, and this is where the foot will be placed on the final assembly. And now you can see that the destructors have been adequately placed so that the destructors start working sufficiently. Yes, got this right so far? Very good. Now what we do is we start with the fixation of the frame. Now the child will be anesthetized. There is no need for any tourniquet here. We mount the prefabricated construct like this onto the limb. Now then we start, Dr. Kirpal. Now insert the first wire.
Now what I do, I put
first tibial frame, tibial points, or what I call a stable base.
Yes. So now Dr. Kirpal is introducing the first tibial wire, and this should be exactly perpendicular to the long tibial axis.
Yes.
And parallel to the knee joint line or ankle line. Any questions? Can you have a mic towards the audience, please? Can a mic be provided for the audience? So, any questions? Speak out in the mic. Please, mic for the gentleman there. Now the first wire has gone in. Now we will be fixing it with the fixation bolts. You see here, this is a situation where you need a washer. There are certain ring manufacturing companies who will not, whose rings and the holes might be little different from certain other companies. And these wire fixation bolts might not sit comfortably on these holes.
Yes.
If it stands proud, then it will not give you a stable fixation, and when you tension from the opposite side, the wire keeps gliding out of the translated hole. So what we need to do is we add a washer, like how it's being done here. So you can mix two companies, no big deal, but keep washers ready to circumvent the situation. Now the wire will get tightened. Now you, when you tension it from your contralateral side, nothing, no gliding of the wire problem in the future. Hope this point is, every point is a learning experience here.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Mike.
Sir, why the...
Speak into the mic, Doctor.
Keep the mic close enough, speak
in the mic. Sir, why?
Can you please stand up?
Sir, why the calcaneum ring is placed more towards the medial side?
Because there is a deformity. There is a hind foot varus, there is a fore foot adduction.
Hmm.
Both these have to be accounted into the prefabricated.
So why the distraction, and that will help it?
You can see that you must mark the exact shape of the calcaneum. Now you can see here. Now you see here, this is the shape of the calcaneum. This is the long axis of the heel. So this heel ring is exactly perpendicular to the long axis of the heel. We haven't made any error. If we try to make it perpendicular to the foot, then we will be going astray. Then we will not be able to get the heel position right. We have to break the deformity. It's a complex deformity. It is not a simple equine of cavus deformity. Sometimes you will be blessed with such simple cases too, where it is equinus, or where it is just equinus and equine of cavus. In those situations, what we do is we don't need the 4 foot adduction correction assembly. So it's very simple single deformity. Now you have to mentally break down the components of the deformity in your head and address each individually. And this is best addressed in the order that Dr. Ponsetti had suggested. Now the second tibial wire is being introduced again through safe corridors. The transmitter wire.
Yeah. Medial side.
Okay. So the second wire is being introduced. Dr. Kirpat is a very expensive surgeon. He's not comfortable with washers. Now the second man has gone in. Now again we use the caution. These wires need to be tensed from the opposite side. We are just avoiding that step for the sake of saving time. Now the TBL ring is in place. Now you will get a fair idea of the ring being in position. Now, if you look end on, you can see that the ring is perpendicular to the long axis of the limb. If there is any mistakes, you can correct it now with washers or anything. Now it is perpendicular. Now this is a perfectly applied tibial ring.
This is perpendicular. See.
Now this is a perfectly applied tibial ring. Now everything starts from here. Now you can see that the forefoot falls exactly in the right place. You see here? A metacarpal, transmetacarpal twin. That's fixing 1 to 5 metacarpals or whatever number of metacarpals will easily fall into this foot ring. Yes.
His place should be at some angle 1 minus correct.
Yes, we'll be adjusting that at the time of final.
Okay.
Point rightly stated by Dr. Arvind Verma Jankit.
Come over here, Arvind.
These hinges are placed in the wrong points.
Yes.
For the sake of convenience, we have done it now. We will be adjusting it at the end. We will have to glide it now, little bit down.
It will have to in the medial malleolus and lateral malleolus.
Yes. That is the level of the subtalar joint. That is the place where the deformity needs to be corrected. Addressed.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
By correcting equinocavirus deformity, whether every time we need to do TA lengthening?
No, not necessarily. Not necessarily. TA lengthening helps us in speeding up the procedure. Elizabeth Purist will not want to do TA lengthening. He will try to lengthen the TA by the Elizabeth methodology.
I do TA lengthening. It is a mini invasive, simple three cut with a scalp knife only. Because it will help in varus also, along with equinus correction. Main thing is varus.
So we need to keep the hinge at the right place. We'll do it after the fixation. Put the pins, it'll be more easier. Now.
No. So excuse me.
Yes.
Yeah. About the PM. What is there any importance of PMR and PLR? Is posterior medial posterior?
Yes, Doctor. What's it? Posterior medial release.
Yeah, release.
With,
yeah.
Yes.
And continuing with this method.
Going to fix with
Elizabeth. Yes.
If you are going to fix with Elizabeth, you just need to release plantar fascia. And if you can do percutaneous TA lengthening, that is very good. Because if you are saving peritoneum, then you will get good regeneration of TA again.
So there is not a strict necessity to do a extensive posterior medial release like just we do in open CTV fashion. But there's no, not
so
exactly needed.
Basic pathology of CTV is bone is elastic and soft tissue is bone. Soft tissue act like the bone. So what you have to do is only lengthen the soft tissue.
So far everything is right?
Incremental graduation of distraction.
Hilbert.
Now he's introducing calcaneum wire, right?
Okay. Now heel has a very good corridor. We have to make sure that you can even apply 90-90 degree wires in the heel. Provided you know you are posterior tibial and peroneal vessels.
It should be perpendicular to the calcaneum long axis.
Yes, Doctor Zandi.
In CTV mostly if you do without CM, it's very difficult to differentiate subtalar joint. Should be careful, your wires should not be in subtalar joint. Just quite little bit away from subtalar joint.
I will give you
that. And in the plane of calcaneum deformity.
Yeah. This is a wet sponge that you put your wire in.
You see, axis of calcaneum is going like this. So your wire must be perpendicular to this axis.
You do the camera, you look at the camera.
Oh, okay.
You just face the camera.
There are some people sitting here.
So that people see you. Why don't you
first see the axis of the foot.
No, don't look here. Look at the camera. Think the camera is audience.
That is like doing cameras to fix that.
No, that's camera is audience.
See here. This is the axis, and your wire must be perpendicular to this axis. So your wire will go from here to there in this direction. So I think this wire is perpendicular to the axis of this code. This will guide when you correct all deformity, this will become like this.
See, this ring is small, half ring is small. What I do foot plate only, full foot plate.
Foot plate will not have an
action. No, not foot plate. This type of plate. Extension plate.
Now we'll try to get the heel ring at the right place.
அரவிந்த்
கி சுல்தா
So this is third wire.
This is third wire.
And
it should be olive wire.
Adding a calcaneal wire, one wire being an olive wire.
Olive wire and one is plain.
Greatly increases the hand foot strength. So we need to add the support wire.
And olive should be on the concave side of the deformity. So that when you correct, it pulls the bone.
So we
will
introduce the olive wire to this.
That is the
Yes.
This wire doesn't matter
what axis you are, but it should be 30 degree with the calcaneum, our first wire.
Small difference in technique here. I in calcaneum always use two olives facing opposite direction from lateral to medial, medial to lateral.
Yes.
In this way, it stops the calcaneum moving side to side on the half time. And especially when you are doing deformative correction, the limb has tendency to come in. So once you have an olive, it's an acceptable pattern. But two olives in pairs in calcaneum is what has given me good relief. And sometimes in metatarsals also, I pass parallel rings with one olive on the first metatarsal head and one olive on the fifth metatarsal head. So that again, it stops the leg from shifting. Because again, in the past, I had seen that the leg had drifted towards the ring. And then the ring dug into the foot. And then he had some ulceration on that part, necrosis, partial necrosis. So it's an easier technique.
You know, for olives, more the merrier. As you keep increasing the number of olives, the stability of the construct becomes more and more better. But here, the reason why we are having olive on the concave side is that the side where we absolutely need it. That is the where we are, deformity is going to be corrected.
So this is
where we expect the heel ring to migrate.
We are pulling the calcaneum like this.
Having on the convex side is an added benefit. Now the olive has to be buried inside. It has to be parked on the medial cortex of the calcaneum. Yes. Now here you can see that this wire is falling off the ring. How do you circumvent this situation? You can use a plate and you can use that to connect to this distraction rod. So we'll have to make a slight frame modification. You have to use the male post's extension will be too small to cover the entire thickness. So we might have to add a rod with a female post. Female post. Yes, we have female post here. Hope you all got this. Now this
Yunus, please.
This cannot, the length of this projection cannot effectively cover the thickness of the ring, the thickness of the plate and the thickness of the nut. So what we do is we circumvent this situation by using a female hinge.
Okay, now he has made a contracting hinge now.
You explain differently. Just if you put a small threaded rod to get a length,
here.
An expansion on, put it on female.
You use a one inch threaded rod.
The second rod you can't do.
Each surgeon has their own.
No, it's not confused. I know. Let him do this way.
Yeah.
That's very simple way. Very, very simple. Tomorrow, I expert.
Assume this rod. This is a quite a long rod. Assume this is a short rod for the sake of completion. We will make a female hinge and a rod combination. We use this. Instead of this male post.
You come this side, you are hiding the camera. Please, you come back of this.
Instead of this male post. There are various ways to circumvent the situation and each surgeon has their own solution.
This
all are equally sound.
This is small ring.
So actually not
it should be your ring.
Our aim is to the incorporate this. So
yes,
you can have a small extension phase. If it's too longer, this extension phase anyhow. So what we will do is
So there are various ways to correct this, recommend this situation. Each one is equally sound, and that is the problem of having too many cooks. But each one is equally sound. Could have circumvented the situation by using a contracting female post on the opposite side, then mount it with a twisted plate and fix it again. We need a twisted plate. So since we can easily circumvent the situation, so don't change the wire. we need wire spread, that is also most equally important. But this rod is projecting, getting out extra. That is not what we want. The rod should stop short here. We
use that. Use after calcanium, we will go for metatarsal. That is metatarsal.
Metatarsal or metatarsal?
I use metatarsal.
Okay. So metatarsal first. I am using. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, and fifth will be my will be metatarsal joint. That is calcaneo cuboid. And last one is metatarsal.
So this is a situation which we frequently encounter. There are times when we have to do a quick modification of the frame just to accommodate one wire. So you don't have to do a radical change, only a simple change like this. Only thing is, this rod should be small. We should have a 5 centimeter rod or 3 centimeter rod. So,
okay, next.
Yes. Now, what is the technique of metatarsal field that you should use from the back?
Yes. My technique is from medial to first metatarsal to third metatarsal. No doubt Dr. Prakash is saying that all you can't bead all the metatarsals in a single chain.
That will lead to
clouding and somewhat metatarsal arc will be disturbed.
The foot has three arcs. One is the medial longitudinal arc, the lateral longitudinal arc, and the arc on the transverse aspect. And this arc is completed on keeping these two foot together, feet together.
It is a tripod stance, what we call.
It is half arch here and half on the opposite side. So if you try to transfix all the five, it is technically possible, feasible. Sometimes that will lead to a less painful frame than a frame that Dr. Kirpat is suggesting. But in order to have a proper deformity correction frame, we need to transfix 1, 2, 3, then 3, 4, 5. Two wires.
5, 4, 3.
5, 4, 3.
From lateral to medial.
Yes. So we'll pass those two wires now. Dr. Kirpat is the expert in passing wires now, so we'll make him pass all wires today.
So, now where will you put olive over here? Yunus.
Tell me which is the convex side, which is the concave side? Medial side is the? So, where do you want the olive? Medial. When in doubt, put olives both sides. More the olives, the merrier.
So I think this is going on beautifully, and possibly for the first time anywhere in the world, this sort of interactive workshop has been tried on real life models. I'm feeling very proud and happy. So immediately after you finish it, you can go back to the tables. You are going, actually we had 300 K wires reserved for this conference, depending on the number of tables. But yesterday itself, 210 K wires have been used. So we have to keep on, so we are running short of wires.
Okay.
So this way, you are not going to cut and bend the wires.
If you are going to pass single wire metatarsal, then always your olive must be convex side. Because if you correct deformity, the tendency to shift toward outer sides. Okay, if you are passing two wires, then one from medial side and one from lateral side.
So that's not the full of the olive. We should also keep in mind the shift of the forefoot during the time of correction. And sometimes we face this messy situation, the foot going and hitting the foot ring, and we don't even have a space to do a fit track dressing. So, better put on both sides.
On one can buy more.
And the child is too small, try to use 1.5mm system. 1.5mm system, which is easier to use in smaller children. Now, we have passed the first olive, 4-foot olive. That is transfixing first, second and third metatarsal, accommodating the transverse arch of the foot.
See, this is first, second and third metatarsal. Oh, sorry. Yes, it's coming out in third, fourth web space.
Fourth web space.
Now, you put another wire. No doubt, Arvind is telling olive on this side, but it can be a dual olive, but there is no necessity for olive on this side. I don't know why is.
If you are passing single wire in metatarsal, always pass wire from in olive must be in convex side. Because if you are going to, if you are going to correct like this way, with ring,
okay. You are going to correct in this way. Okay, so here is no olive. This foot will shift here. If your olive is here and olive is fixed over here,
it keeps
then
foot in the center.
Not come here.
It keeps foot in the center.
Okay, so if you are passing one only, one wire only, you only must be at convex side in every deformity correction, not only here.
So when the corridor is narrow, like in metacarpal, always have olives on both sides, it gives you a better translational stability. And the benefit of olive is only achieved when the olive is parked on the cortex. As long as it's not parked, it's a simple part. This is the bed sponge that we hold.
No, it is not bed sponge.
Now this is exiting through the
third metatarsal,
the second third space. Now the olive is parked on the surface of the fifth metatarsal. Now we have a very sturdy foot construct. We have a very sturdy foot construct. Now we have to place the foot in the appropriate place and fix it by fixing board. This will take a central hole, this will take an eccentric, this will take a central hole, and this will take a bifurcating buckle. If you do not have a wire fixation buckle, then you can mount a one hole post, a twisted plate, then another plate.
Now about metatarsal wire, it should be there because it will break the mid-foot and forefoot joint line for equinus. I usually prefer sometimes talus wire also. If talus is in equinus, you have to lift the talus because talus is the epicenter of CTV. If you relocate the talus laterally and superiorly, CTV will be corrected on its own.
That is the original Ponseti principle.
Now, what is the Ponseti principle? First, which correction to be done? Anybody? Cave. It is a cave. C-A-V-E. C means cavus, A means adduction, V means varus, and then last is equinus. Right?
Yes. But in Ponseti, what we do is, we adduct a supinated foot. We external rotate a supinated foot. That is a dictum in Ponseti. The foot is kept in supination, still you keep external rotating the entire carpopedal unit below the talus. And here, the reference point is the neck of the talus. It is being famously said that the kite method failed because the surgeon kept his thumb at the subtalar joint. And Ponseti's method was a redeeming success because the surgeon kept their finger at the neck of the talus. And it took at least 90 years for the surgeon to move his finger by 1 centimeter.
Now, we are changing the hinge and we are not repeating the procedure. Anybody can distract now.
Wonderful. Now, this is the workshop we are going to do. Now, one caution, do not tension these wires, cut them or bend them, because these wires are going to be used for the afternoon workshop also. We are getting a lot of wires. I have asked for some extra wires. We get it well and good.
Now,
if not, okay, just leave like this. That's the way we want to do.
As Dr. Arvind Varmajani pointed, the hinges are not at the subtalar joint. This is the time to change it now. Now with the foot in the prone position, you just decrease this length and decrease this length, increase this length and increase this length.
Now distraction rate, what I follow is 1 mm per day. Dr. Yunis, I don't know.
Mike. Distraction rate, 1 mm or 2 mm per day. For Dr. Yunus, I don't know.
I don't come from Mars. It's the same, you have to maintain differential distraction so that the concave side gets distracted more and convex sides less. And tomorrow you will see all this principle again reenacted in the form of jets. It's essentially the same.
Another posterior distraction rod I am using usually at the same tendo Achilles center and limb center. That will align your limb exactly and you can distract. Posterior distraction is the main part of CTV.
For equinus correction.
Yes, for equinus correction.
One important thing, where to put hinges.
take fine wire, 1.5 mm wire, and pass that wire to some parallel joint. So where is the wire? This is ACA.
Sinus Garci.
This is ACA. This is the point where you must put hinges because you are going to distract subpellar joint. Got it?
And ankle
axis is oblique. Subpellar joint axis is also oblique. So you have to be more on medial side.
Yes.
And lateral side.
Yes.
I'm done.
Okay, have you understood? Any doubts now? You can start asking the faculty. Yes, please.
On the mic, please.
Mic. One question generally, do you want us to split the tables and give a list of names or we'll manage yourselves? What do you say? What does the audience say?
List of
friends? List of people, numbers. Okay, so then 1 to 12 on table 1, 12 to 24, doesn't we split. All tables have been numbered, so you know your registration number. So go to your table accordingly. So 1 to 12 on first table, 12 to 24, 24, 36, 36, 48, like that. You've got 15 tables now. So everybody can be accounted.
Is there a need for neutralizing assembly on the front, Dr. Kirpal?
Yes. I usually put a T plate over here.
Yes.
It is like a T plate. One rod.
A neutralizing this, assembly?
One rod this, one over here, one over here. So it will bind it or pronate, whatever you want to do.
These are added features.
It is already mentioned in Elisara Pupals, that is great in Elisara. Already mentioned.
Yes, how Dr. Jangid, what do you do?
I put polydirectional hinges over here.
Yes.
With use of.
Show the polydirectional hinges.
The Somin.
You can make.
With this one. So you have movement like this and this.
Do you use such hinges, Doctor?
No, I use this type in this.
It repairs on table.
Put this in the
so
over
these
here.
Hinges. Yes. This is a neutralization rod. This is effectively a neutralization rod.
This is neutralization rod, but we have option of holding everywhere.
Yes.
You see this one. If we're going to correct virus, this will move like this. So this is polyaxial hinges. You have correction angles in the. With the use of this polyaxial hinge, you can correct in any direction. Virus, bulgars, equinus, everywhere. For virus correction, this will move like this. And once you correct it for equinus, just rotate a little bit this here, 90 degrees. So now this will move like this. Okay?
Shall
we move to the table?
Yes.
We didn't answer this question yet.
Sir, I want to ask, we had applied
hinges,
but to correct the periscope.
What?
For periscope, we had applied hinges.
Yes.
Okay.
Why we didn't apply any hinges for correcting the, we had applied straight
rods
for this
additional deposit. So, in your, you never need that we had applied hinges for correcting.
This one is acting as hinges. If you keep this one loose,
this will
rotate.
Rotate.
Okay? This will act as hinges. One here and one here.
So we are making a hinge by just a single hinge. And this hinge is rotating on the hind foot assembly, thereby making it a dynamic hinge. So we are trying to keep the inventory to the minimum so that the fixator is not bulky at the same time.
You see,
better done this way.
Here is connecting rod.
this will move like this.
So the connecting rod can move as the adduction gets corrected. You see here, as this, as you keep distracting on this side and decreasing it on this side, or rather differentially distracting on this side, what happens is this.
This
is purposefully kept loose.
Yeah.
So this is purposefully kept loose. So this hinge will keep getting more space and keep rotating as the correction proceeds. Similarly, this hinge is also kept loose. You can see, you can appreciate it on the video. What is this? Oh, your question is answered. Yes.
Okay, I think we have the levels. So according to the numbers, you can get to the level. And we will break for lunch at 2. 1:45 to 2. Lunch will be ready for 1:30 itself. Now, coffee tea is on here. 5 minutes.